Qubits sound really complicated, but they really don't have to be. Like, this laser is a qubit, and an electron by itself is a qubit. A trapped ion can be a qubit. There can be superconducting qubits. There are so many different things that can be qubits. Fundamentally, the only thing that matters is if it is a two-level quantum system. And all two-level quantum systems are qubits, and they're basically the same, at least mathematically. But when you're making them in the lab, you might decide to use one type of qubit over the other because it's more stable or it's easier to manipulate, whatever it is. But fundamentally, at the mathematics level, they're all the same. So let's talk about what a qubit is. So this laser pointer here has a little polarizer in front of it, and that polarizer makes sure that all of the light is polarized in this direction when it comes out of this laser pointer. So this is polarized this way, but I could rotate it, now it's polarized that way, etc. And so there are many, many different states that this light can be in. But if I was to measure the polarization, then there will only be two outcomes that this measurement can resolve. So here's an example. This block of calcite measures polarization. So if I put this in front of my laser, it splits it up into two dots, and those two dots have opposite polarizations to each other. So what I mean by opposite is that they're 90 degrees away from each other. So one of them is at 45 degrees, and the other is at 130 degrees. So you could think of this calcite as measuring the polarization, but it only allows two options. It can allow light to go through that now has 45 degree polarization or 130 degree polarization. But what if I rotated this calcite by a bit? So if I rotated it like this, now this calcite measures a different set of polarizations. In fact, if it was measuring 45 degree and 135 degree light, and I rotated it like this, then now it's measuring horizontal and vertical light. This is why, even though this light has so many different options for what state it's in, we call this light a two-level system, because when you measure it, there's always two outcomes. No matter which way you measure it, there's always going to be just two. And so fundamentally, this system is two-dimensional. So here's what I mean by that. Let's suppose I start off with my light pointing in this direction. So its state is represented by this. By the way, I'm going to put that inside of a thing called a ket. That's just a way in quantum mechanics of marking that this thing represents the state of this thing. So this kind of means a state. What will happen when I measure this light with this calcite that's oriented like this? This calcite breaks up light into two options, horizontal or vertical. So that's light that's pointing this way or light that's pointing that way. Now, one of the key concepts in quantum mechanics is this idea of superposition. We say that this light is really a mixture of both of these types of light at the same time. Like, this light is clearly pushing somewhat to this direction, but it's also pushing upwards. And so really, it's a combination of these two. To decide how much of each of those two options we have, we need to put coefficients in front of these vectors. In this example, I've put 1 on square root 2 in front of both of them, and this just means that there's an equal amount of both. But what if we chose to measure this light in some other direction? So instead of horizontal and vertical, let's say we rotated it kind of like this. So now we have to write that same light in terms of two other options. So now we have to figure out what these coefficients are going to be. And you can see that this coefficient should be pretty big because this is pretty much the same as that, but this one should be quite small. This is called a change of basis. So we've just changed how we look at this same light. So this light is equal to being a bit horizontal and a bit vertical, but it's also a bit equal to this and this at the same time. And in fact, there's never anything special about which direction you choose to do the measurements in. But for quantum computing, we choose one direction as our sort of like fundamental direction, not for any actually good reasons, just we choose one and then we go, okay, so in this basis, option one, we're going to call that zero. And in this basis, option two is going to be called one. So let's say that I chose horizontal and vertical to be the 0 and 1. I've just relabeled these. I haven't actually changed the physics of that light in any way. But now you can kind of see why you might call this a qubit, right? Because there's a 0 and a 1, and we're saying that this light is in some sort of combination of both 0 and 1 at the same time, which is what you might have heard people say about qubits. But an important thing to note, though, is that this state really is both 0 and 1 at the same time, right? Like, if it was just 0, it would be fully horizontal. If it was just 1, it would just be vertical. But we know it's something else. It's something kind of in between. And so that's all people mean when they say that qubits are doing two things at the same time.
Okay, sorry to interrupt, but I have an announcement. There's going to be another cohort of the live version of this course in January. So it's a 4-week course, and once a week we meet to go over the homework problems, and the students get to like ask any questions they want. So I just finished a cohort and it was so much fun. And a lot of the students emailed me to say that they thought they understood quantum mechanics at least somewhat before doing the problems and realizing that there's actually more to it. I really believe that doing problems is the best way to learn physics. So that's why I came up with this course. So if you're interested in doing that in January, then there's going to be a link in the description. Thanks.
Light isn't the only example of a qubit though. Electrons can also be qubits, and that's by using their property called spin. So an electron's spin points in a particular direction, and just like with the calcite and light, we can measure the spin of this electron in many different directions. So the way that you measure spin is using a Stern-Gerlach machine, and those machines can be oriented in different ways. As it's oriented here, it's going to measure whether the spin is up or down. So again, there's only two options for this particle, even though actually the spin could be pointing in any direction at all. When you do a measurement, it collapses it to one of two options. And that's again the sort of two-dimensionality of this state. So when I'm measuring this electron in terms of up and down, then I can think of its state as some combination of up and down. But I could also orient this Stern-Gerlach machine in the left-right direction and write our state as a combination of left and right. Both of these two options for writing this state are equally valid. Both of them are true. But I might decide that really I am more interested in up and down, and I might want to make them the sort of canonical directions. And so just like with the light, I might relabel up and down to 0 and 1. But light and electrons are not your only choices when it comes to making a qubit. And actually, if you're making a quantum computer, there are much better choices. And that's because you want your qubits to be very stable, but also very controllable. And I don't think that the light or spin are really either of those. And so instead, people use things like trapped ions. So for example, a trapped ion can be made into a qubit. Okay, so I just looked this up this morning. Ytterbium, apparently that is an atom that you can make into a trapped ion. So you take the positive version of this and you trap it in like a magnetic trap, and then it has two ground states. So a ground state is sort of the lowest energy state. And when I say that there's two ground states, what I really mean is that there are two that are very, very close in energy. It's like a hyperfine splitting of the ground state. And so those two energies can kind of act as your two options for the qubit. So one of them is 0 and one of them is 1. The reason why that's apparently a good choice is because you can use microwave radiation to jump between those two or go into superpositions. And so all of the gates in the quantum computer are made using microwaves to manipulate the state. So yeah, that's a really nice example because it technically isn't a two-level system. Like, yes, there are these two energies that are very close to each other, but there's loads of other energies for this atom as well, right? The electron could always jump to higher energies, but they can safely ignore those higher energies because all of the manipulations they're going to do are only going to be between those two lowest energies. So yeah, that's a really cool way to make a qubit because most things aren't naturally two-level systems. So if you saw a state like this written down, with a combination of 0 and 1, you wouldn't be able to tell whether we're talking about light here or we're talking about electrons or something else. And that's kind of by design. The purpose of writing 0 and 1 is to abstract away all of the messy physics and just bring it down to what's fundamentally important about this state, that it is some combination of these two directions. This also helps us draw the state as a two-dimensional vector, exactly like we did with light, no matter what the actual qubit is made of. And that's really useful. If I have the state A times 0 plus B times 1, then all I need to do to draw it is to draw 0 and 1 here, and then I want to take A steps in the 0 direction and B steps in the 1 direction, so maybe to here, and then I link them up. This is my way of drawing the state, which completely abstracts away the physics. And so no matter what type of quantum computer you're talking about, everyone can use the same language. This also leads to a bunch of common shorthands in the quantum computing community that I really like. Like, for example, the plus state is an equal superposition of 0 and 1. So what do you think the minus state is? It's 0 minus 1. You might be thinking, how can this be negative? Well, actually, it makes perfect sense if we think about it as a vector. If we have positive 0 but minus 1, then it would be pointing in this direction. And so a combination of 0 and minus 1 looks like this, whereas plus looks like this. And again, if we go back to the light example, that makes perfect sense. This is plus, and this is minus. But you can have even weirder things. So these numbers can actually be complex numbers. So this is the imaginary number I. Now, you might freak out and think, like, what are complex numbers doing here? But it actually can make a lot of sense. Let's go back to thinking about the spin of this electron. We said that the spin of the electron could be oriented all kinds of different directions. But what about this direction? Or something like this. Why aren't those allowed? Well, they are, and the way to represent them is through complex numbers. So for example, this state is represented by 0 plus I times 1. And that kind of makes sense if you think of the I direction as like the third dimension. So you have your 1 pointing this way and your negative 1 pointing this way. In between, you have I, and that's pointing upwards. So that's how it works out. With light, it's a little bit more complicated. Like, what would this state look like for light? Because we said that we're allowed to rotate this light around in any direction, and that's all fine, but those are all just like the real ones. What would this state do? Unlike with the electron, we can't just sort of rotate the laser, because that doesn't really work. Like, polarization is about the direction of the polarization relative to the direction of motion of the light. And so only these ones seem valid. So all of the polarization we've talked about so far is linearly polarized light, which is always pointing in one direction. But there's circularly polarized light, which changes direction of polarization as it travels forward. So that is what this I represents, and different complex numbers would represent being more or less circularly polarized. So yeah, for every qubit that you can write down, when you translate that back into the physical system, there is some way to get this object to behave so that its state is actually equal to this. And that is why it's so useful to abstract away and write things like this, rather than always thinking about the actual physical system. Because no matter what architecture you use for quantum computing, you will always be able to write states like this and manipulate them, and guarantee that there is some way that you can make this all happen in the real world. And that is someone else's problem.